And these guys, they bless me. They bring the presence of God. And you know what's fun? Is they love to bring the presence of the Lord. They're not here to just entertain you, but they have incredible skills and ability. And I know usually there's an old guy on the platform. He didn't make it today. He just got back from Mississippi late last night. Dean's not with us. But Kenny's leading out in the electric guitar. I told him, I'm going to have you solo. Would you just worship the Lord with them as they use their skills? How many of the Bible says, praise him on the stringed instruments? Come on, man. Praise him on the stringed instruments. Go for it, man.
Not much of a soloer, but I'll just play for you guys for a second.
Thanks, man. Amen. You guys feel good? Everybody doing all right? I'm excited, man. Thanks, buddy. Thanks, guys. I think these guys just do so much for us. And I really, really, really incredibly value the worship that we have in our house. I'm addicted to its presence. I love the presence of God. I love what we experience in this room. My greatest desire is that this is not the highlight of your week with God. This is just celebrating God for what he's doing all week in your life. There has to be, and I say that, I think you guys know I love to preach. We're having privilege to preach all over the country this year, and God's opened up a bunch of doors. But in the place of that, what I'd share with you is that the corporate anointing in this house is awesome. I thank God for it, and there is something to that. And I could share with you a whole bunch about that. But what I really feel is that, man, it's our individual walk that God is just really targeting right now in my spirit. In the month of March, I will really bring across. I'm going to talk a lot about the practicalities of our walk with God, and just what that looks like on a day to day. And I'll talk about a bunch of things. But I feel like God's really, really just speaking to me about, I don't know, maybe it's falling in love with him again. Because we've got to get that, man. That's just got to happen. So I feel like the Lord's teaching us. I feel like the Lord's helping us. I feel like there's a bunch of good things that are going on. I feel good. You know, in the Lord's Prayer, he said, give us this day our daily bread. In John chapter 6, Jesus said, I am the bread of life that's come down from heaven. And I feel like when he says, give us this day our daily bread, it's that daily portion of Jesus in our life that sustains us and strengthens us, that keeps our hearts pure before him. And every day there has to be something fresh. I actually believe that God will bring you something fresh every day from heaven that will sustain your walk, that it never gets old, that it never gets stale, that you never get tired of it, that you never get bored. God, I got to tell you something. When I first, and I'll be real, when I first gave everything to Jesus. And I mean, when I got saved, I was one of them guys who got radically saved. But I thought, okay, it's going to be a long ride. You know, I got to tell you something. It just keeps getting better. And it really, really does. And it never has to get old or stale. I'm going to bring some stuff to you today that I feel like the Lord showed me about finances. I'm going to talk about finances today. People get nervous when you talk about finances in church, right? But that's okay. I like it. We're going to talk about this. You know 750-some scriptures? I think 757, if I remember Larry Burkett's number right, about finances. So evidently, God's pretty interested in finances. There's only 37 scriptures about heaven. 757 about finances. Amen. Wow. I guess God's interested in that. Am I okay? People freak out about money. I understand the story of a very wealthy man that claimed to be a Christian, but every time he was in trouble, he found that he could buy his way out of trouble. You understand what I'm saying? Like, you pay enough people enough money, you can get your way out of anything pretty much. And that's what he was doing. And then he got really, really, really sick. He got really sick. And when he got really sick, the doctors kind of came to him and said, listen, man, we've done everything we can do. There's not much more we can do. You're just going to have to go home. And let's see what happens. And so he's at home. He's lying in his bed. And he brings his wife in the room and he says, honey, I need you to do something. He said, and you do exactly what I tell you. She said, okay, what do you need? He said, I want you to go down the bank. Get all my money out of the bank. Every last dollar. She said, what for? He said, I want you to take it up in the attic. String a clothesline all through the attic. She said, why would I do that? He said, then I want you to hang all my money on the clothesline. She said, seriously? He said, yep. And on my way up, he said, I'm going to grab it all and take it with me. So she's pretty challenged by that statement. And so she thought, okay, I'm going to do what he said. So she did. And you know what happened? 2 weeks later, he died. And a week passed, and she didn't go up in the attic. And another week passed, and she didn't go up in the attic. But at the third week, she couldn't take it anymore. So she went up in the attic, and guess what? All the money was still there. And she looked at all that money hanging on the clothesline, and she said, I knew I should have hung it in the basement. Anyway. That's another message for another morning. We're talking about finances a little bit today. I want you to go with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 9, but I'm going to share something with you. What I'm going to read to you today is actually from the English Standard Version. And there's a reason I'm doing that. I have a Bible. The Bible that I'm holding in my hand is actually, it's a very special Bible to me. It's Spiro Zodiades. His notes are all through this, if that's the right words. But Spiro Zodiades is the leading authority in the world on coining Greek. And coining Greek would have been the dialect of the language in that day. And his notes are just incredibly valuable. And I was reading out of this Bible as I was doing it. And I just loved the translation, the way it said. It was just a bunch of powerful things. It's all keyed to Strong's. It's just a whole bunch of neat stuff there. So anyway, in the midst of all that, what I'll share with you is, I'm going to read this out of the English Standard. They may have it on the wall in the King James. It's okay. It all reads pretty much close together. But follow with me, because I'm going to read the entire 9th chapter, and then we're going to take it apart. Everybody okay? And we're going to learn some stuff today. It's going to be fun. Okay, you going to have fun? Can I preach on money and you still love me? Amen. Amen. You better, because you have to. It's in the book. Okay. Go to chapter 9. Let's take a look. He said, now it's superfluous for me to write to you about the ministry for the saints, for I know your readiness, of which I boast about you to the people of Macedonia, saying, the people of Achaia have been ready since last year. And your zeal has stirred up most of them. But I'm sending the brothers so that our boasting about you may not prove empty in this matter, so that you may be ready as I said you would be. Otherwise, if some Macedonians come with me and find that you're not ready, we would be humiliated to say nothing of you for being so confident. So I thought it necessary to urge the brothers to go on ahead of you and arrange in advance for the gift that you have promised, so that it may be ready as a willing gift, not as an exaction. Everybody see that? Now watch. The point is this: whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he's decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. As it is written, he's distributed freely. He has given to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. Now watch. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You'll be enriched in every way to be generous in every way, which through us will produce thanksgiving to God. For the ministry of this service is not only supplying the needs of the saints, but is also overflowing in many thanksgivings to God. By their approval of this service, they'll glorify God because of your submission that comes from your confession of the gospel of Christ and the generosity of your contribution for them and for all others. While they long for you and pray for you because of the surpassing grace of God upon you, thanks be to God for his inexpressible gift. I love this chapter. I was just reading this stuff because I was kind of looking at some financial things for the month of February, and this thing just started to jump out to me. It's really, really powerful, so we're going to break down that in a minute. But if I would give you one other verse today, it's Romans 8 and 14. We're not going to turn there. I'll quote it for you. It literally says this: as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Amen. Now, you know what's really cool? That actually says that sons of God ought to be led by the Spirit. How many believe that your life ought to be led by the Spirit of God? Watch, if I gave Christ my life, now if I only incorporate Jesus in, my life isn't going to be Spirit-led. But if I gave him my life, then I don't have a life to live. I gave it away. And if I gave it away, that means it's his to call the shots, not mine. Now that's really cool, because what that actually says is if my entire life is his, that means all my problems are his, all my worries are his, all my finances are his, all my stuff is his, even my bills are his. If I literally gave my life to him. Does that make sense? All right, we're going to talk about that, because I believe as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. That means every area of my life needs to be Spirit-led. Watch. That doesn't just mean my ministry. That doesn't just mean what church I go to. That doesn't mean what prayers I pray. That means every area of my life. That means my physical life ought to be led by him. That means my marriage ought to be led by him. That means my relationships ought to be led by him. That means, watch, my ministry ought to be led by him. My finances ought to be led by him. I believe in this so strong that I want to do something this morning. Come here. Please. Thank you. I want my wife to share this thing for just a second. Go ahead.
If you know much about things that I like to enjoy and do, one of them is giving. I can't see those people over there.
That's...
You're going to have to step up here a little bit more. I would like to see all their smiling faces. And I
can't. Sometimes the Holy Spirit sounds like a woman.
Well, I can't see. Now I can see. See, I couldn't see. Now I can see Ruby. I couldn't see her. She was waving. And anyway, so part of some of the things that I like to do, I'm really big on communion. I'm big on prayer. I'm big on giving, and I'm big on fasting. Well, today I get to talk a little bit about the giving part, because I love to give. I have seen the blessing of giving in my life. I've seen the sowing and reaping principle played out numerous times throughout our marriage, throughout my childhood, and it could be because I was brought up that way as a child. My mother was always out there giving. She was giving, not even so much even in the financial aspects. My mom was this amazing baker.
Hallelujah.
She was always baking. You know, she was of the older generation, so, you know, the fresh cinnamon rolls, the fresh bread, you know, all that kind of stuff.
Yes.
A great cook. But she was always baking it and then just taking it. I know. She was taking it to the neighbors. You know, she would take it on Sundays to the pastors. She would take it everywhere. She was just always big into the blessing and the giving. So I think I learned that principle a lot from her. But I just believe that you can never outgive. You can just always do and do. Whether you're serving within the local church as a greeter, a cafe worker, a children's ministry, whatever it is you're doing, you just do it to the very best that you can do. But the idea of just giving and sowing and reaping is just so fun for me. Do you ever just like to pull up to Dunkin' Donuts because I'm not a real big Starbucks person. Sorry, guys. But I like Dunkin' Donuts. So I'm pulling up to the Dunkin' Donuts, and there's two cars behind me. So I'll pay it forward, or in this case, pay it backwards. When I go to pay my bill, I'll say, hey, you know, the next car behind me, whatever their bill is, add it on mine. And just when they pull up, just say, Jesus loves you. Have a great day. They don't need to know who I am. They don't need to know what church I go to. They just need to know that there's someone out there that loves them. And it just makes you feel good. How many times have you stood in line, and I've had it recently, a lady was at the dollar store, and she was paying for some of her stuff, and she just didn't quite have enough. And I had my debit card still in my hand because, unfortunately, I'm a very bad person. I don't carry cash. But I have this cute little plastic debit card that does everything for me. And I just slipped it right through the little machine. And she said, oh, no, you don't have to do that. Here, take what cash I do have. I said, oh, no, sweetie, it's not about that. Today's his birthday time. You just celebrate Jesus' birthday and just love on your kids. Doesn't that make you feel good when you just get to do just a little bit of life stuff? You know, just have fun with it. Well, I want to have fun a little bit today. So, who has your bulletin in your hand? Everybody got your bulletin. Pick your bulletin up. Now, your bulletin's a little different than first service. So, first service told you what we're going to do. It doesn't really matter. Because it's different in the second service, because that's what moms do. We get to be a little tricky and ingenuitive and all that kinds of stuff. So on the front of your bulletin, February is an extra special month to me because it's Valentine's Day and because it's my birthday. So if on the front of February, on the front of your bulletin, is in this beautiful shade of red, run up here to me real quick. If February on to you is in the shade of red, run.
Cool.
There should be about 10 of you, I believe. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I got eight. Someone's not looking at their bulletin. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. There's 9. Come on, look at the front of your bulletin.
It was the youth that went upstairs.
I'm
anybody got a red pen? You want to color yours in real fast? Okay.
Okay, that's good. Well, we'll just find out later where number 10 is. But okay, Miss Kim, come on up here with me. Miss Kim's going to hand you an envelope. And inside this envelope is some money. This month, during Financial Freedom Month, we want you to be blessed. We want you to be free. We want you to have the freedom of sowing generously and have the spirit of generosity that you can just sow. You can just sow envelopes or their money. That I don't know, you know, envelopes are different amounts in them. But sow it when you get to do something. Have fun with it. Whether maybe you're at the restaurant and you want to pay someone's bill. Maybe you're at Walmart and you just see someone struggling or wherever. Let the Holy Spirit speak to your heart and just do something fun. In the spirit of generosity with whatever amount is in your envelope. Thanks, guys.
Amen.
Anybody getting ready to go on a mission trip soon? I know Larry was in the first trip. You going on a mission trip? Here, honey. Come on, I'm not going to hold it up here all day. I'll give it to someone else. There you go. Be blessed. There you go. Touch a life wherever it is you're going. This month, in the month of February, is our Financial Freedom Month. We've done it now. I think this is our sixth year, maybe seventh year of financial freedom, because we did it on the other side before we were in this building, and we've been in this building going on 6 years. So we even did it when we were on the other side in the older building. Financial Freedom Month. February is always our Financial Freedom Month. And for many, many years now, we give literally thousands of dollars away that you sow into, we sow right back out. Because whatever you partner into, remember, you receive and get blessed for. So in the month of February, we will sow back into you somehow thousands of dollars that you can be released and you can go out there and you can make a difference somewhere in the lives of someone throughout this month, because we want you blessed. We want you financially free, and we want you to hear from God in the spirit of generosity and just out there in the kingdom. Love you.
Thanks. Cool. I think all of our giving ought to be spirit-led. Do you believe that? Sure. And we'll talk about this because I almost feel like we got a legalistic mindset in the body of Christ that was never meant to be about our finances. Is that okay to say that? I don't want to get legalistic about all kind of stuff, you know what I mean? And next thing you know, we're counting pennies, and it gets kind of crazy. So I'm going to talk to you because I think a spirit of generosity ought to be the rule. So me and Barb think that, and Dustin. Okay. Okay, come on, we're on it, okay? Listen, let me talk to you. I'm just going to get real plain with you, so let's go. Because we got to look at what Paul says about this. Go to 2 Corinthians 9. We're going to take this thing apart, okay? Because I think it's really, really powerful. We got to look and feel about our giving the way God wants us to see that. Does that make sense? Every gift should be God-centered. Every gift ought to be God-centered, and I think that's really, really true. So he gives us two kinds of giving that are contrasted in verses 5, 6, and 7. All right? So go with me to verse 5, and let me show you what he says. Verse 5 says something I think is really strong. Watch this. If we start at verse 5, watch. So I thought it necessary to urge the brothers to go on ahead to you, right, and arrange in advance for the gift you have promised so that it might be ready as a willing gift, not an exaction. Everybody understand, like, an exaction means like a tax, right? So what's he say? He just made a contrast. What are the contrasts? Willing gift, exaction. One is by pleasure, the other's by pressure. How many understand it ought never be about pressure? It ought to be about pleasure, right? Oh, that was really good. I'm preaching better than you're receiving right now. Okay. It shouldn't be about pressure. It ought to be about pleasure. That's a big deal to me. Now watch, okay? Because he says some things that are huge. Verse 6. The point is, whoever sows sparingly will reap sparingly. Whoever sows bountifully will reap bountifully. Another contrast. What's he saying? Sparing, bountiful, right? Come on. Willing gift, exaction, right? Bountiful, sparing. Everybody see it? Now watch, okay? Another verse, because he does the same thing again. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion. God loves a cheerful giver. So now we got reluctant giving versus cheerful giving. Do you understand that in those three verses, what was he doing? He was identifying two different hearts. You got the reluctant heart, you got the bountiful heart. Everybody see what I'm saying? This one's sparing, this one's bountiful. This one's reluctant, this one's very, very cheerful about the giving. Everybody see that? Okay, so we got to talk about that because what Paul was doing was saying our giving is really a reflection of how we see God and what we think in our heart. And that to me is a big deal. So I'm going to look at some stuff, okay? Okay, because the first thing he says is this. He says, if we look at how not to give, it stems from a desire to hold back. Everybody understand what I just said? Sparingly. Sparing means to hold back, right? If you need somebody to help you, you say, spare no effort. What are you saying? Don't hold back any effort. Come on. Right? Right? Come on. In the same thing, spare no expense. If you're building something, spare no expense. What's it saying? Don't hold back on the expenses. You do whatever needs to be done to make this the way it needs to be. Right? Come on. God spared not his son. What's that mean? He didn't hold back his son from us. Right? So the desire, the sparing heart is the heart that desires to hold back. The sparing heart is the heart that says, I'll give because I have to, not because I want to. And the sparing heart is looking at what it can keep, not what it can give. When he talks about the sparing heart, that's the picture that you have to see. Then he talks about the bountiful heart. Right? Because he brings the adverse out in the next verse. And he says, God, there's a bountiful heart here that shows. And when I start to look at the bountiful heart, it really speaks to me from another place, right? Okay? Bountifully translates from the basis of blessing. Our giving rests on the truth that God is a bountifully blessing God. So our gift ought to be a bountiful blessing to the people that are around us. Can I say this? Your life is a gift to the people around you. Amen. This doesn't just impact our finances. It impacts every part of our life. If you're living, I'm going to say this, if you're living accumulating friends according to what they can give you, you're just messed up. Good. We ought to live our life with the idea of what can we do to be a blessing to the people that are around us, not how can the people around us bless us. Your life ought to be lived with the idea of, man, how can I be a blessing? How can I lend you your life? I want your life to be better because I'm in it. I don't need my life to be better because of you. I need your life to be better because of me. Does that make sense? Why? Because if I'm pouring out, and that's what God created me for, guess what? How many understand? He said it's better to give than to receive, right? When you're giving, when you're pouring out, there's great joy that comes with that. We went to Honduras. Most of you know we were in Honduras for an extended stay because of the snowfall, but we got to bless a bunch of people, got to pour into a bunch of people, and it was absolutely amazing. And can I say this? We were in garbage dumps and orphanages. They couldn't do a whole lot for us. But we didn't go for them to do for us. We went to do for them and had the best time ever. Why? Because you didn't come to get something. You came to give something. I even have people to talk about church. Well, I went to such and such a church, but I didn't get anything when I went there. Well, you're not supposed to go to get. You're supposed to go to give.
Amen.
What if we went to church every week with the idea, what do I have to bring to the service today? Oh, that's good preaching right there. I didn't preach that to the first group. So if you see them, tell them. Oh, it was probably more for them than you guys. No, never mind. No, I'm just kidding. There's this bountiful heart, right? Giving bountiful. It's from a heart that wants to share. Before I was saved, I was very self-centered and wanted things for me. Then I got saved, and all of a sudden, it's almost like a switch flipped. And it wasn't about what could I get. It was what could I give. It's like a magnet, if you can see the polarity of a magnet. The magnet's on, and what's it doing? Sucking everything in. Right? The stronger the magnet, the more it sucks. Come on, you guys know this. Right? But what happens when you reverse the polarity of the magnet? Now, all of a sudden, the very thing that used to suck now is pushing out. Why? That's what Jesus does. You were trying to suck everything in for you, and now Jesus comes in, switches the polarity, and you're saying, what can I do to bless and give rather than how can I give or get and be blessed? I want to give and be a blessing, not get and be blessed. There has to be that. This is what Paul's talking about here. He's contrasted two hearts, the sparing heart and the bountiful heart. Everybody see that? Now, out of that contrast, he begins to speak, and he actually addresses it from a really, really strong place, and I think it's kind of neat, because the sparing heart sees God as a taker. With his pointing finger, give me, give me, give me. If you see God as demanding, and we did this, I apologize. I was part of the problem for years. We'd preach. There's a Old Testament book. It's one of the Italian prophets. His name's Malachi. Okay, maybe he was Hebrew and it's Malachi. But anyway, okay. But chapter 3, right? And we preached about if you don't tithe, you're under a curse. So people actually gave out of a legalistic response. But if my heart's not in the right place, I'm not sure the gift was ever received as it should be. Come on, we just read, God loves a cheerful giver. And I've preached that. God loves a cheerful giver, but he'll still accept from an old grump. But the blessing comes in the cheerful part. You okay with this? So there's something about it. It's really the condition of our heart that matters. That's the difference. If I see God as a taker saying, give me, give me, give me, then how can I see the needs of this world and pour myself into that and say, man, I'll spend and be spent for the gospel. But if I see God not as a taker but as a giver, the bountiful heart's in a relationship with him that sees God as the blesser, as the giver, and he's not a taker, and it lines up with God, and it sees him as the supplier, the helper, the all-sufficient one. You give, and you know what? You're replenished when you give. You feel good about giving. It's like, it's exciting. I didn't tell on him. But you know the biggest giver I know was in our morning service? Pastor Dan. I've watched him give more money in a month away than some of you make in a year. I've watched him do it. I wish Rick was here. He'd testify to it. Rick's his treasurer, really. But I'm on his board. I know what he gives. Ridiculous amounts. And he blesses people. And that's why he's got that goofy smile all the time. because he understands it's more blessed to give than receive, man. But he does it, I'm telling you, he does it all the time. And I've watched him do this. And he just sows into people because, and what's really cool, can I share this with you? When I talk about spirit-led giving, I've watched him come home from a trip, and he said, man, I got to take care of some business today. Holy Spirit's been on me for a couple of days, and I know I need to do this now. And it's writing checks that are fairly large to either ministries or individuals because he heard God speak to him while he was away. And he said, I know as soon as I come home, I got to take care of this. And he'll respond to that, and without fail, because he has this incredible ability to hear God, so do you. Did you hear me? So, Dan doesn't have a better ability to hear God. He's just gotten sensitive to it. Y'all follow what I just said? Your ability is the same as his. It's just gaining a sensitivity. It's not about ability. It's about sensitivity. But over and over with tears, it was received in just the nick of time. Because God's a good, good father. Oh, I feel really good right now. Here's where we're at. If you see God as the blesser and the supplier, then you know what you're doing? You're giving, and that's easy. You feel good about it. You're not drained. Why? Because you see God as a giver. That's cool. He's not the great taker. He's the great giver. So the biggest issue is, how do we see God? Because if we see God in the right perspective, and Paul knows this, so he addresses the issue of how we see God, and he starts talking. And he actually says, here's how God works. He gives on both sides of the giving. First, he'll supply your seed. And then he'll bless your harvest. Watch this. I'm going to tear it apart. Let's just go for it. Go with me to verse 8. Watch this. I love it. I feel really good right now. I'm preaching on money and I still feel good. Yeah. Now watch. Verse 8. God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. Do you understand what he just said? He shows us that God's a bountiful God. That means he's omnipotently able to supply whatever we need to be generous. Why? God wants his people to be generous. He really wants you to be generous. It's a good day. So watch this. It's the spirit of generosity. I could talk about it for a long time. I will later on. Okay? But I want you to see this because it's really strong. Because he's a giver. So verse 9, watch. Because he goes back to the seed thought. Right? As it is written, he has distributed freely. What's that mean? He sowed. He's going back to the same seed thought, and he's saying, he distributed freely, he's given to the poor. What's he saying? You sowed your seed. You've given to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. What's his righteousness? It's the harvest of that seed. Now watch. Watch verse 10. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing. Now wait a minute. He supplied seed for the sower and bread for food. What's that mean? He gave you seed to sow and then bread to eat. Why does he say that? Because he's saying, don't eat your seed. If you eat your seed, you're in trouble. Every farmer knows if you eat your seed, you can't have a harvest. But what happened is, we ate our seed. Can I really, really, really talk to you? And actually, this hit me in the middle of preaching in the first service. I didn't plan this, but it was so powerful. Watch. What happened in the body of Christ, because I just believe this, there should never, ever, ever, ever be a need financially in the body of Christ. If we were faithful to the outlines and the guidelines of Scripture, there would never be a financial need in the body of Christ. I know that. That's absolute. There wouldn't be a need in this house. There wouldn't be a need in any house. We'd actually be able to be sowing into ministries like crazy if we were all faithful in the ministry of finance. Everybody all right? That's not being hard. I'm just being very real. But what happened is we didn't steward real well. Remember that I talked about spirit-led giving and we gave you an envelope and said, let the Holy Spirit guide your giving? We probably need a sermon on spirit-led buying. Good preaching, preacher. Right? Because watch, we impulse bought, and then we got ourselves and became slaves to the lender. And now because I'm a slave to the lender, I don't have the money to sow. Because watch, Susan's going to go on another mission trip, I think the Philippines, am I right? Is that what you're talking about? You want to go to the Philippines? Watch. But the biggest challenge is that, watch, what's the biggest challenge for her to be able to go? Finance. right? So a bunch of us would be able to sow into her life and bless her to go to the Philippines if that's what she really wanted to do, and we felt God was on it, except for one problem. If we sow all of our money to her, we can't pay the electric bill. Right. Who understands what I just said? Why? Because we got into a point where maybe we got this credit card and that credit card because we weren't spirit-led buying, we were impulse buying. Because we've been trained by the television set. Did I say that? Spirit-led buying is probably just as important as spirit-led giving. That we pray about everything. We got a keeping up with the Joneses mentality. So watch what he says. He supplies seed for the sower and bread for the eater. What's that mean? Eat your bread, but don't eat your seed. Sow your seed. God will give you what you need to eat. Why? Philippians 4:19 says, my God will supply all of our need according to his riches and glory. I think he's doing pretty good in glory. I don't think glory's broke. Must be riches and glory, right? So God will supply our need. But what happened is we started going past our need into our wants, and it started to eat into our seed. So now I don't have the seed to sow to get the crop that I need and produce the harvest. Everybody understand what I just said? This is good preaching right now. Now follow with me, because I just want us to see what Paul says, because he gives us some really powerful solutions, okay? Watch what he continues to say. It gets kind of neat. So he says he'll supply seed to the sower and bread for food, right? Then he says he'll multiply your seed for sowing. What's it mean? Increased ability to be generous. That's a good word. The increased ability to be generous is a powerful thing. It's right here in the Word of God. And this is what he says. Now watch. I love this. He'll multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You'll be enriched in every way to be generous in every way. Yay, God! Which through us will produce thanksgiving to God. Wait a minute. What's the, you see all the benefacts of being faithful? Because when we're generous, it just increases thanksgiving to God. If Brian's in trouble and we can bless him, he's giving thanks to God. Pastor Lori handed Susan that envelope. The first thing she said, thank you, God. Come on, why? Increase thanksgiving to God. Why? From a spirit of generosity. When we start to sow into the people around us, when we start to bless, come on, I will tell you something. And Pastor Lori, she laughs a little bit because sometimes I say this. The voice of Holy Spirit sounds feminine in my life sometimes. I think I'm married to her. So anyway, but we'll go to a service. We'll go to a church service. Doesn't matter where we go, right? Come offering time, she pulls out either the envelope or the checkbook, either one, and she starts to write the check, right? And she'll say, what are you hearing? Right? It doesn't matter. No, really, it doesn't matter. If I say, I'm hearing 25, she's hearing 50. If I'm hearing 50, because I feel like this is good soil, let's sow, man. I'm 50, I think 50. She's like 100. Because she's always like twice whatever I'm thinking. Someday I want to go 500 and see what she does and just freak her out. She'd be like 1,000. But listen to me. In the midst of all that, and I think this is important that we catch this, there's a place where no matter what's going on in our life, as we're allowing Holy Spirit to guide this, this is what really, really matters. And what he's actually saying is that when we're generous and we're able to sow, let's just use this, and I'll just use this for example. Oftentimes, we'll go to dinner, right, and it'll be on her heart or my heart to really tip well, because we like to do it. I like to bless waitresses. And so sometimes it's at least 100% of the check, if not more. Like, if the check was $50, the tip might be $50. Is that okay to say that? And I don't say that in any bragging way or anything. It's just sometimes God speaks to our hearts that way. And what'll happen is, we've had waitresses chase us down in the parking lot, because maybe we left them a $100 tip, and they're crying, I never got a tip, and I had this need. And Lori will just go, I knew you had a need. God showed me your need. And we can just talk to him, minister to him, bless him. Jesus loves you. Let me pray for you. And that's happened. I don't know. But you know what happens? It's like, thank you, God. Thank you, God. And you know what's done? It's exactly what Paul said. When we have a spirit of generosity, it gives an increase of thanksgiving to God. Everybody see that? That's a powerful tool. Right? But over and over, this is what he's talking about. And he's talking about allowing our giving to be led by Holy Spirit because of the impact that it makes. So God says, and this is his powerful stuff, he's going to bless the seed, right? And then give us a greater ability, an increased ability to be generous, right? And then he says, and this is huge. If it's more blessed to give than to receive, then guess what happens? As you're given, your joy becomes greater. It feels good. You start giving like Pastor Dan, pretty soon you'll be smiling like him. You'll be like, all the time. It's a good day. Wouldn't it be cool to be known as the Smiley Church? Why? Because we understood the power of the blessing that comes by giving. Okay, now watch, because it's even more strong. Because he goes on and he says a whole bunch of neat things right here. Look at the next couple verses, okay? Verse 12, for the ministry of this service is not only supplying the needs of the saints, but it's also overflowing in many thanksgivings to God. Watch, come on. He says it again. I think it's really powerful. But now he says the needs of the saints are met, and there's more increased thanksgiving to God. What's that mean? That means God's getting praise. You just became the instrument that God could use to bring a blessing in somebody's life that God would receive the thanksgiving. Isn't that really all you want to be, as a conduit of blessing? God, flow through me. Let me be a blessing. Let me touch lives. Let me make a difference. Let me make an impact. Over and over, this is like what God says. I think it's incredibly powerful. It just makes me happy. But I see him, watch what it says. He said he'll increase your seed and then he'll bless your harvest. So he's the giver on both sides of the offering. Do you get it? He increased your seed. And all he wanted you to do was sow it. Then once you sow it, he can bless it, and the harvest will be amazing. Everybody understand that? That's a big deal to me. So I see that over and over. It's just kind of fun. So in the midst of that, it's talking about having a spiritual generosity. That's really it, right? Now watch, this gets kind of cool. Now watch verses 13 and 14, because it gets strong again. Watch what he says. By their approval of this service, they'll glorify God because of your submission that comes from your confession of the gospel of Christ and the generosity of your contribution for them. Everybody see that? That's huge to me. What did he just say there? He just said something really strong. By their approval of the service, they'll glorify God. God got glory because of your obedience. Last night, Sherry Cashman was here. She preached an amazing message on obedience. Really, really good, powerful, fun. She's like a female Brandon Hess, by the way. Just telling you. Very, very similar ministries. But in the midst of all that, it's out of that place, and I'll say this, it's not partial obedience. Can I say this? Partial obedience is still disobedience. Amen. Is that okay? Because a half-truth is really just a lie in disguise. A half obedience is just disobedience in disguise. You okay with that? Out of this place, he says, out of your obedience, God gets glorified. Am I living for his glory or not? I want God to be glorified in my life. Now watch, because I'm going to go here. He says one more thing. While they long for you and pray for you because of the surpassing grace of God upon you. What's that mean? They long for you. They love you. And what do? They pray for you. Do you know anybody in this house that doesn't want to be loved and prayed for? Come on. Oftentimes when I know somebody's struggling, sometimes I'll just send them a text that says, just a note to let you know you're loved and prayed for today. And you know what? I think it makes all the difference in the world. Why? Because I haven't met anybody that said, stop praying for me. I have too many people praying for me. That's never happened to me. I'm 56. That's never happened yet. I don't think it's going to happen. People want to be loved and prayed for. He said, out of your obedience, right? Watch. God gets glorified in our life in a lot of ways. God can get glorified when we use our gifts and our talents for him. But is God glorified by our financial life? I'm going to talk to you, man. Really, really strong. One of the things that God's really, really been thumping my heart about is this. We have a house that knows how to host the presence of God. We host his presence well. We do this amazingly. People come from all over the country. They come to this house. And you know what they always say? Without fail, oh my gosh, the Spirit of God in this place is amazing. I don't know what else is out there because I work here. I just come here every Sunday. But evidently, there's a lot of other stuff out there. I don't know, but I know what's here. And we do. We host his presence really well. And you guys do that. It's amazing. We host his presence well. We just have to learn how to host one another better. Amen. We do this well. We got to learn how to do this well. This is a big deal to me. This is something God's really thumping my heart about, Brian, is we got to do this better. Because I'm going to say this, this relationship has to impact this relationship. And I'll even say this, if this relationship is not impacting this relationship, then there's something wrong with this relationship. We need to go back and re-examine this. We thought we were hosting them well, but if I'm hosting them well, I'll host you well. I can't take love in and not give love out. And if you're hosting him, you got to take love in because God is love. Actually, in 1 John, it even says, how can I say I love God who I can't see if I can't love Dave who I can see? And Dave's pretty easy to love if you hang around him enough. He has a few senior moments, but he's okay. It's that silver fox thing, you know. But it's okay. In the midst of all, and that's a big deal. It's hosting him. It's loving him. If we can host him well, and I believe in this, man, then we got to be able to walk this thing out in such a place that Holy Spirit thumps our heart in every area. And I'm talking about Spirit-led living, every area, every area. That's every. I believe all of our giving ought to be Spirit-led. But that's not just our financial giving. That's every area of giving. And according to the Apostle Paul, I ought to lay my life on the altar as a sacrifice. That's giving. Whew. Is God glorified in my financial life? That's a big deal, isn't it? God, are you glorified? I'm going to go here. I'll just meddle now. Can I meddle for just a minute? I believe that Christians, and I talked about this a few minutes ago, and I said about the idea, the challenge that we have is we'd probably do better financially if we weren't slaves to the lenders. Let me say this. You got to pay your bills. You make a bill, pay your bills. Don't pay your bills and walk, or make bills and walk away from them. We're Christians. If I make a bill, I've actually made a commitment. And I can't walk away from my commitment and feel like that's okay with God. We make a bill, we pay a bill. Is that okay? That's called Christianity 101. We got to pay our bills. The fact of the matter is that we as Christians, we ought to be blessed. Hey, can I say this? Was Abraham blessed? Do you know this? When Abraham left out of Ur of the Chaldees, he was one of the most blessed men on the planet. He was incredibly blessed. But you know what happened? God said, I'm going to bless you and make your name great. I'm going to bless you. Do you know what he said? To be a blessing. Do you know you're blessed not so you can have it? As a matter of fact, if I can understand what the Holy Spirit's speaking right now, it really comes along the idea of God didn't bless you to be a hoarder. I read about a guy that was a hoarder. It's in the book, right? What did he say? He said, oh, my barns are full. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger barns. And I'll say to my soul, take thine ease, eat, drink, and be merry. And God said to the rich man, watch what he said, you fool. It's the only place in the Bible where God called anyone a fool. He said, you fool, this night your soul will be required of you. And then whose will these things be that you hoarded? Am I right or not? Come on. God's just really speaking to me that, man, I want God to be glorified in my financial life. Not just my ministry, not just my marriage, not just my children, not just whatever. My financial life. I think that's a big deal. And how does that come? By letting the Holy Spirit direct us in all these things. A spirit of generosity gripping our hearts. God gave me seed not to eat, to sow. But if I don't sow, I'll never have a harvest. Do you ever hear anybody say, I'm waiting for my ship to come in? You know what, when they tell me that, you know what I say? Did you send one out? Your ship ain't coming in if you didn't send one out. Come on. You can't wait for your harvest to be reaped if you didn't sow. Am I good? This is right. Come on, I'm right. So I'm just speaking to us from my heart tonight because you know why? Here's what's really in my spirit. And I'll say this. We're doing well at Harvest. We really are. We're not broke. We had the best year. I don't know. We probably had somewhere, but I had it figured at 21% increase last year. I think it might have really been 17. But we had the best increase we've ever had. And can I say this? From 1997 until 2015, every year we've only increased, right? We're not hurting. This message is not, oh my gosh, we need your money. We hired Dave. Okay, that's not just message. We're doing okay. Okay. Really, I'm just saying. Okay. This isn't about we need. This is about I want you blessed. Amen. Why? Because if you're blessed, you can be a bigger blessing. The only reason you're not being able to bless is because you haven't gotten blessed. And when I'm reading the Apostle Paul, he's actually giving us a formula saying, hey, sow your seed. Eat your bread, sow your seed. God will bless your seed, give you more seed to sow more seed. Why? So he can increase the harvest in your life. Yes. It's a good word. It's actually really encouraging. I'm going to go home and write a check. God wants to be glorified in your financial life. He wants to receive glory because that's what it is. And then, did you see how Paul finished the whole chapter? Thanks be to God for his inexpressible gift. What's he saying? If you want to measure, look at the gift God gave. That's really what he just said. He took all of our giving and then tried to compare it to that. Did you get it? Why? Because that's the nature of God. God gives. He's a giver, not a taker. If you see God as a taker, every time you write the check, you're going to, oh my gosh. Sometimes we get to offerings, and Brian deals more with that. I don't deal with finances, but for years I did. And sometimes you'd have a $20 bill that was so crinkled up, you knew they were really having trouble turning loose. I was like folded and crunched and twisted. Okay. Yeah. Man, it's so much more than that. It's your heart. Do you actually know when he says God loves a cheerful giver that the Greek word for that is hilarious? Yeah. Can you picture somebody coming up to the offering like this? Oh, God, I'm going to give an offering. You never saw a fat man twirl, did you? Come on, man. I can do it. Shoo. But it's the word, man. It's just amazing. And this is what God's challenged us. Can we do it with a joyful heart? Can we do it and see God as the blesser and the omnipotent, all-sufficient one who's given us seed to sow? Because if he gave me seed to sow, I'd actually be afraid to eat it. Does that make sense? If I went to Nell's grocery store in the morning, on a Sunday morning, and I bought donuts, and the donuts were $10, and I gave the lady at the register a 20, and she handed me my donuts, and I walked away, and she didn't give me my change. And you came behind me, and she was stressing because, oh my gosh, I didn't give Pastor Dawn his $10. And she said, and you said, oh, I go to Harvest Chapel, he's my pastor, do you want me to give it to him? And then she handed it to you and said, would you do that? Could you give it to him this morning? I feel bad. I don't want my register over, but I don't want him missing it. He might need it. Would you give him that $10? And you took that $10. There wouldn't be one of you in this building that would even consider putting it in your pocket and keeping it and saying he don't really need it. But have we done that with the seed God gave us to sow? If Leviticus is still true and the tithe is the Lord, is holy unto him, then are we eating our seed and that's why we're not reaping the harvest? I'm just being real. God, teach us. He's teaching us. But I want to do it with joy. I want to do it and it ought to feel good. It ought to be right. And we watch the blessing of the Lord and we see the increase and God gets thanksgiving. All the factors are written right here in 2 Corinthians 9. It's just really powerful. Stand with me. We're going to pray. Because I want God glorified in my financial life. How about you? It's the bottom line of it all, man. I want my life, my ministry, my marriage, my family. I want everything. I want God to be the giver in my life and yours. So what? So he gets the glory. Every area of my life, God received the glory. It's a big deal. Feel good? I'm excited. Teach us, Lord. We have so many amazing things coming up. And I'm just saying, Lord, help us to steward everything that you're giving us well. Some of you know, Pastor Lori and I have another mission. We have to take the gospel to the sin sick people of Hawaii. And we are. I'm going preaching. I'm really going preaching. Some of you know Todd was there right before he left for Dallas, right? And he preached for a couple of weeks. I'm going to go fix it. Somebody has to. Okay. But when I think of all the opportunities that we have and all the challenges that are around us, we have this incredible opportunity. You're given one life to steward. Everything about your life, you're called to steward. Every dollar that you get, if you gave your life to Christ, is His. And He just calls us to steward it well. Do you understand what I just said? See, in the Old Testament, the tithe was the Lord's. But in the New Testament, it's all His. Because I gave Him it all. And all He does is call me to steward it well. Something in your heart, man?
Yeah, I actually do have something. It's so weird for me to do this. I don't ever do it.
Yeah, you've never done it, so I'm going to give you grace.
So
I didn't even come and ask him, like, dude, what are you going to say?
Okay, no, go but for when it. When we were doing worship, I smelled... It's so weird. I was like doing worship and I smelled cigarette smoke up here. And I was like, man, that's weird. Like nobody, you don't smoke here. So I kind of just left it go. But when I was sitting back here listening to the message, I felt like God say there is power here today to deliver people in the crowd that are smoking so you can take that money and bless other people. So
that's cool.
Yeah, it was crazy.
Wow, so, stay with me. Stay with me. Do you understand what you just said? That's really powerful. I love when God's doing these things. Because I felt like there was a power. Remember what I said? Whatever you soaked in last night, that's what you smell like today. What you soaked in yesterday, you smell like today. Remember I talked about Esther? Watch, man. Because listen to what Kenny just said. He said there's a power to break off the things that are keeping us back, whatever that addiction might be, whatever that challenge might be, right? And be set free from that. Watch. At $5 a pack, if you smoke 20 packs in a week, that's $100. I guess that'd be a lot. Is a carton a week a lot? I have no idea. Huh? That's a lot. Okay. Yeah, stop it. Okay. Okay. So there. But here's the reality of that. I don't know. I don't, whatever. Because I really wasn't a big smoker. But watch. Here's what I will tell you. If you find yourself battling with that because that word's just released, the testimony of Jesus, spirit of prophecy, right? So watch, man, this is happening. And if you're in the place and you're saying, you know what? That's me, Pastor. I know it might be bold to walk up front and say, you know what? I want that deliverance. I'm always in faith with somebody who wants to quit, right? Can I share something with you? This is a very powerful testimony, but there was a guy that had terrible lung problems and he came forward for prayer and he had a pack of cigarettes in his pocket and Dan was still praying. It was Saturday night services when we were doing them. And the guy asked Dan, would you pray for me? He said, what's going on? He said, I want my lungs healed. And Dan said, are you willing to quit smoking because they're destroying your lungs? He said, no. He said, then I can't pray for you. I'd be in faith with you if you were willing to quit. Do you understand that? That's a big deal. But what Kenny just said is a very powerful thing. If you're here this morning and that's a deliverance that you're looking for, I'm going to begin to pray corporately over the entire church that we understand that our life is an offering, that God would get glory from our finances, that that's a big deal. But if you're here and that word resonates in your spirit, I want to break the bondage, and I'll call it what it is. It's the bondage of nicotine. We understand that. It's okay. You know what I mean? And watch, the bondage of nicotine isn't any worse than the bondage of sugar. But we don't have room for an altar call for that. So we just took the meddling right there. but there is. There's incredible things to all that. But watch, caffeine, same thing. Honestly, if you get a headache when you don't drink coffee in the morning, you have a bondage. right? It's just a big deal, okay? Just being real. But if it's a nicotine thing that we heard, it's the cigarettes. And if you have, if it's in your heart, that's a desire for you. While I'm praying, I'm going to invite you to come. And because Kenny received the word, I'm going to ask him to lay hands on you. I really feel like there's power in that, okay? Everybody all right? All right, listen, we're praying. Get glory from your story. We're asking God to get glory in your financial life. Something in your heart, man? You going to try to top Kenny? What was that?
I come alongside of Kenny. I smoked for 20 years. And 5 years, when I got saved, about 5 years into it, my spiritual dad sewed into me. And he said, we were in adult Sunday school, and he said, I forget what verse it was, he asked me to quote, and I said, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, Philippians 4:13. And he says, I don't ever want to hear you quote that again. And I said, what do you mean? He says, because you don't believe it. He says, you wouldn't still continue in sin if you believed that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. About a week later, I went to the altar call, and I was up at the altar. And I don't get many visions, and I put my hands up to the Lord, and I got a vision. And I saw Christ hanging on the cross with the holes in his hands, and I heard him clearly say to me, I did this for you. You can't put that down for me. I quit right there. I put it down. That was the end of it. So you can be set free, and you can be set free instantly.
Okay. Amen. Amen. We're going to pray. If it's in your heart, I'm going to invite you to come. Okay? I'm going to have Kenny lay hands on you. If there's a whole bunch, I'll recruit Virgil. Okay? We'll be ready. Everybody okay? Father, in Jesus' name, I just thank you right now. I pray that our hearts would be so filled with your love and your grace, your goodness. God, that in every area of our life, we're just being led by your Spirit. I'm asking, God, let the Holy Spirit be an overflow in our life. And as it is, God, I'm asking, Holy Spirit, come, fill us up to the point, Lord, where we're overflowing, led by your Spirit in every area. Our ministries are led by your Spirit. Our marriages are led by your Spirit. God, everything we do, including our giving, is Spirit-led. Not only Spirit-led giving, but even Spirit-led buying, that we're not compulsive buyers, that we're not impulse buyers, but God, that we're stewarding our finances well. Teach us what that looks like and help us to do it, oh God, immensely well in your favor. I pray for your grace and your goodness to overshadow us, and I ask you, Holy Spirit, come right now, touch us. God, I thank you. If you're here in this place and you want deliverance from nicotine, you want to quit smoking, if you want to come forward right now, I'm going to have Kenny lay hands on you. Father, I'm asking in Jesus' name that you would touch us, that you would help us, that you would encourage us, and God, that we would see the victory through Christ. Holy Spirit, I welcome you right now. Just come in an amazing fashion. Touch our hearts, touch our lives, that we would never be the same again. God, I thank you for making the way. I thank you that you're a faithful God. I thank you that we have a high priest who is touched by everything that's going on in our life. And I pray for a grace, God, to overcome, a grace to be strengthened and encouraged in every way. Lord, we just break any bondage in our lives right now. We just cast it off, and we thank you, God, for victory through Jesus Christ. We bless you. We thank you. We love you. God, we want to make your name great. We want to make your name great, God. Give us a spirit of generosity to give thanksgiving to God. Give us a spirit of generosity to make your name famous. God, that we would do better, that we would steward well, that we would be, God, the people you called us to be. Help us, Father, to sow our seed and eat our bread and never eat our seed again. Teach us the difference, God, and help us to do it with great just intention, that we'd be intentional in our finances and everything about our life, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Bless you, man. Thanks for being with us. Anybody else want special prayer? Everybody good? Bless you. Hug somebody. You're dismissed. Amen.